So I think we are ready to go here. Hello, everybody. I'm Karen Percy, a former ABC journalist, and I'm your MC for this event. And thank you so much for joining At Risk 2021, the virtual conference hosted by Housing for the Aged Action Group and the University of Melbourne. We're discussing solutions and action to address the crisis in older women's housing. We've got a great lineup of guest speakers and panelists today, and a very big crowd indeed who are tuning in. Some 880 people have registered for this event, so there's clearly a great deal of interest. Now, last week's National Women's Safety Summit highlighted the need to address the systemic problems that are making women unsafe in Australia. Housing was a key factor. Structural and systemic gender inequality and a lack of investment in appropriate and affordable housing are responsible for this acute problem, where an estimated 405,000 women over the age of 45 are in danger at risk of homelessness. That's a staggering and, I think, distressing number. We have a good understanding of what's causing the problems, and there are lots of solutions. But people have had quite enough of talking, thank you very much, about the issue. And today we really want to shift the agenda, compel our political leaders, as well as business and the community sector, to act to achieve meaningful, substantive, positive change in housing outcomes for older women. I would like to acknowledge that we have some federal representatives, state representatives joining us today, as well as those from local government, eminent members of the community, and a whole lot of older women who are at risk of homelessness. And you've come together from all parts of the country. It's really great to have you all joining us. A bit of housekeeping firstly, because we are using Zoom, we suggest you use speaker view in your settings. Questions and comments can be made via the chat function, and these will be fed through to me and also the conveners of each of the breakout sessions a little later in this conference. And you can take part in the online Housing for the Aged Action Group discussion forum called House on Fire, bit of a giggle there. This is a website for people to connect, share and take action. Now, please do ensure that your contributions are respectful and in line with HAAG's code of conduct. We will be recording this event, so if you do not want to be seen, please do turn off your video. We've got a very full agenda indeed, and we're going to be hearing from a variety of terrific speakers. They'll be giving their views and hopefully answering some of your questions. We also have some great breakout groups that will be exploring solutions and actions to specific issues in depth, those great panels that we've got for later in the session. Now, very soon we'll be hearing from Senator Jane Hume, the Federal Minister for Women's Economic Security. We also have two incredible women with lived experience who are going to give us first-hand accounts of this growing problem. As well, we'll be hearing from key politicians about what they're willing to do to address this problem. Now, we're going to be taking a break just before noon. It's a quick break, and then the breakout sessions will happen at 12 o'clock sharp. We will be live tweeting and we are live streaming this event, and we ask that you use the following hashtags: hashtag home at last, hashtag at risk 2021, hashtag everybody's home, hashtag housing for safety, hashtag end ageism. That's when you're doing your social media posts, and I'm all sure you'll be doing lots of them. So I would like to now call on Aunty Georgina Nicholson to do the welcome to country for us. Aunty Georgina is a Wurundjeri elder here in Melbourne and representative of the Wurundjeri Tribe Council.
Thank you, Karen. Hello, everyone. My name is Georgina Nicholson, and I am a proud Wurundjeri Woiwurrung woman. Wurundjeri being part of the Kulin Nation. The Kulin Nation consists of five clans, I believe, and they are Wurundjeri, Boonwurrung, Wathaurong, Tanawrung, and Jajawurrung. Wurundjeri being all of Melbourne CBD and surrounding country, extending north to the Great Dividing Range, east to Mount Baw-Baw, south to Mordialloc Creek and west to the mouth of Werribee River. So I would like to acknowledge and pay my respect to our ancestors who walked and lived on this land as free spirits for millennia. I would also like to acknowledge all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who are online with us today, and I pay my respect to you all, to your elders, and to you all. So I would also like to acknowledge that I am pleased to be doing the welcome for this very important event this morning. I would like to acknowledge all dignitaries, the speakers, all peoples on here today. There's a great list of people. So for those of you tuning in from Wurundjeri country, I would like to say to you, Wumanjiga Wurundjeri Balak, Yemen Kundibik. So I'd just like to tell you what I've said in our Woiwurrung language, and that is welcome to the land of the Wurundjeri people. For those of you tuning in from other traditional owner countries, lands, I would like to acknowledge all the traditional owners of the lands that you're all tuning in from. And I would like to pay my respect to all those Aboriginal people and to their elders. As we navigate our way through this COVID-19 pandemic, I reflect on the long legacy of those who have come before me. And I think about the challenges they must have faced, because we're still facing those challenges, but not yet in a lot of different ways. But I do draw some strength from our people. You know, our ancestors started it all for us. They started it all. And then I go down to my mum and her mum and her mum and so on have done for me. I sit here today very proudly for my mother, Martha Nicholson, who instilled great values in me. So I feel very proud and honoured to be sitting here and doing the Welcome to Country today. My mother, Martha Margaret Nicholson, as I said, her maiden name was Terry. She was delivered by her grandmother, Granny Jemima, and that was on Corranduk Aboriginal Mission near the present-day town of Healesville. But Granny Jemima was already teaching our mother the importance of connection to land, family and culture, and caring for one another, of course. So years later, our mother met a deadly Irish man called Patrick, and they met on a blind date in Melbourne in the early 1930s. In 1937, Mummy and Daddy were married. Back then, it was in a registry office, and they had 16 children. 8 girls, 8 boys, all single babies, no twins, no cheating, LOL. I'm the youngest of 16, and the oldest is my sister, Pat Ockwell. Sister Pat, it's actually her birthday today. Can you believe that? For people that know Sister Pat Ockwell, a lot of people know her. She's done a lot for her community and for her peoples. And she's amazing. She turned 80. She turns 84 today. And for an Aboriginal woman to reach that age is a milestone. But they say we don't live as long as other cultures. There's a huge gap. There's about a 12 to 15 year gap or more there. Now, so we do have a lot of Aboriginal deaths in our communities and families. Both my parents have now passed away, and there's only 8 of us kids alive. So, you know, we do have a lot of sorry business in our immediate families as well. William Barak, people that have heard of William Barak, his sister Annie Barak, that is my direct bloodline. So I come from the very strong, unbroken line of Aboriginal women and men. One tradition being our Woiwurrung language, it's part of our rich, deep heritage, and I like to say that our language has been sleeping. Now we're waking it up. So it's good to learn language, and I think it's important to know language. So, you know, that's all happening. We do keep our, keep our culture alive through song and stories, performances, and et cetera. So I'm not sure how long I've got, but the coronavirus pandemic has changed the world in ways we never have imagined, and the implications for our communities have been profound for our health, our well-being, and our jobs. But thank God that we've got this online stuff happening and the modern technology, so we can still connect as peoples, friends, family. It's really great. Look, Aboriginal culture is the oldest living, continuing culture. It dates back to 60,000 years plus. There have been no treaties with us up to date, but there is First Peoples assemblies happening now, so that's good to look forward to. Excuse me. I do believe we are the sovereign owners of Australia, and we have never ceded our sovereignty. But in saying that, I just would like to say to everyone, Wurundjeri people would like to say, respect the land and the waters, the flora and fauna, and of course respect each other. I think that's my time to stop now. I could have went on and on, but thank you very much for having me. Take care, everyone. Stay safe. And Victoria will get there hopefully before Christmas. Thank you to our leaders. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Aunty Georgina. That's a great message about the importance of caring for one another, the importance of community, of course, the prominence, prevalence, importance of our First Nations people, the challenges they've faced over time and now, and of course, the importance of stories and sharing stories. And that is a lot of what today is about as well. So thank you so much, Aunty Georgina. We're going to hear a quick word from our co-hosts, in particular, Professor Duncan Maskell, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Melbourne. Professor Maskell is a Cambridge graduate and a research specialist in infectious diseases. He's also worked at the University of Oxford, Imperial College London, and Wellcome Biotech. Thanks so much, Duncan.
Thanks a lot, Karen. Thanks for your introduction and also for facilitating today's event. I also would like to thank Aunty Georgina for her welcome to country. I will also acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands on which the University of Melbourne stands, and I pay my respects to the Indigenous elders of this country, past, present and emerging, and I acknowledge all Indigenous people participating today. It is a pleasure to be here this morning and to welcome everyone and to express my respect for the impressive work of the Housing for the Aged Action Group. I particularly acknowledge here Fiona York and Kobe Maglin, Fiona as the Action Group's Executive Officer and Kobe as the Manager of National Advocacy and Community Engagement. I also want to pay tribute to the work of my University of Melbourne colleague, Dr. Kate Rayner, who has undertaken extensive and important research into overcoming barriers experienced by older women who are facing homelessness. I want to say personally here that since I was a teenager growing up in London, I have been bemused by the fact that wealthy nations allow people to be homeless. I think it's scandalous, and I think it's something that we really should do something about. I just simply do not understand how nations as wealthy as ours can allow people to be homeless. And the scale and implications of this issue are truly disturbing. Finding solutions that work in practice need to be a priority for all of us at universities, in non-government and government organisations, and in the wider community. This is to a large extent why I'm delighted to see participation today from representatives from across the parties in our federal parliament, including Jane Hume, Tanya Plibersek, Larissa Waters and Zali Steggall. I thank all of them sincerely for joining in today's symposium. So today's online forum is part of the Hugs at Risk series, following on from last year's event that shared research estimating that over 400,000 women over 45 are at risk of homelessness. The ultimate aim of today is to move from awareness raising to practical action on housing insecurity, especially for older women, a highly vulnerable cohort of people who are repeatedly overlooked. We know already that this is a major problem. We know that older women are the fastest growing cohort of people experiencing homelessness. We know that there are a number of factors contributing to this, including challenges in housing markets, precarious employment, living alone, and raising children without adequate support. The majority of affected women have never before experienced homelessness, and that's a sobering reality. So along with gendered violence, this threat to the housing security of older women is one of the most serious moral and political challenges facing our society today, and I really believe that. In short, the experiences of so many women are simply unacceptable to a civilised community. We have to do better. And I believe that this sentiment is shared amongst everyone participating in this event today. And again, I thank everyone for participating. I particularly thank those who have put in the work to create and continue the At Risk initiative. I wish you very well with your discussions today, and I'm now going to hand over to Karen to introduce Senator Jane Hume. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Professor Maskell. Senator Jane Hume is the Federal Minister for Superannuation, Financial Services and the Digital Economy, and Australia's first Minister for Women's Economic Security. She is a senator from Victoria and was elected in 2016 after a career in the financial services industry, where she worked as a senior policy advisor for Australian Super, and before that for the National Australia Bank, Rothschild Australia and Deutsche Bank. Senator Hume is unable to join us live, but we are really pleased that she took the time to send through this message.
Many of the financial issues that women face in retirement, and for some women, their vulnerability to homelessness, are a cumulative result of a lifetime of lower incomes, time out from the workforce, and cultural and structural barriers that prevent them from maximising their earnings potential and life savings. This disadvantage is especially acute if women experience a major change of circumstances later in their lives, such as divorce or illness, or if they're victims of family and domestic violence. Improving outcomes for women's safety, economic security, leadership and equality are priorities for the Morrison government. Already, we have made significant progress on these fronts, but we must keep a laser focus on the challenges that lie ahead and ensure that the policy settings are right to support older women of today and tomorrow. Building on previous record investments in this space, this year the government announced $3.4 billion of funding dedicated to women's safety, economic security, and health and wellbeing in this year's budget. As part of this year's Women's Budget Statement, we made a record investment of $1.9 billion in women's economic security. This funding supports a range of initiatives to bolster women's long-term financial security, including through facilitating pathways to home ownership and bolstering retirement incomes, which are the best safeguard against homelessness. To support access to stable and affordable housing, the government announced the Family Home Guarantee, which provides a pathway for single parents with dependents, the overwhelming majority of whom are women, to access the housing market with as little as a deposit as little as 2%. Now, we know that many single parent families use so much of their income towards rent, and building a deposit is made even harder with the challenging demands of children. This measure is about providing choice to families and removing barriers to home ownership and giving a leg up to those who need it the most. The Commonwealth also made a major investment of $9 billion this year to improve housing and homelessness outcomes. This funding will benefit all Australians, but will have a particular impact for older women. This included around $3.5 billion in Commonwealth rent assistance and around $1.6 billion through the National Housing and Homelessness Agreement with the states, which includes nearly $132 million in dedicated homelessness funding to be matched by the states. Moreover, the Commonwealth-funded organisation NIFIC continues to provide low-cost, long-term loans to community housing providers that offer social and affordable housing for older women and women at risk of homelessness. This includes funding to St George Community Housing to support older single women, and particularly those who identify as Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander, and people experiencing family and domestic violence. We know that the impact of family and domestic violence are devastating and require significant investment in prevention, emergency assistance, and long-term rehabilitation. This year's budget allocated $1.1 billion in dedicated funding to support women's safety. Funding within this package included bolstering the Safe Places program, which is set to deliver 43 emergency accommodation projects to assist over 6,000 women and children fleeing violence every single year. Over half of these projects will be delivered in regional and remote Australia, where women face additional challenges accessing targeted services. The National Plan to Reduce Violence Against Women and Children, which will be informed by the Women's Safety Summit, will provide a roadmap for future investments to improve women's safety and reduce their vulnerability to homelessness. Finally, the Morrison government is committed to improving retirement outcomes for women. In this year's budget, we committed to removing the $450 superannuation guarantee earnings threshold, which will bolster superannuation for thousands of women with low incomes or with multiple jobs. In addition, we are legislating this month to improve the visibility of superannuation assets in family law proceedings. Superannuation is often the most significant asset in a separated couple's asset pool. And too often in divorce proceedings, women are left with the short end of the stick. This reform will make it harder for people to hide or underdisclose their superannuation assets to ensure that women have equitable access to retirement assets that can prevent their vulnerability to homelessness in their older age. Finally, it's important to recognise a strong economy gives all Australians more choice and opportunity. As we come out of the pandemic, the Morrison government is focused on cementing our economic recovery to ensure that there are jobs available for those who want one, improving economic security for all Australians, including women. And now, more than ever, the government is providing Australian women with opportunities to retrain and learn new skills to participate more fully in the workforce in high-demand sectors of the economy. The challenges of homelessness are significant for all Australians, but for our older women in particular, they are the most vulnerable. I'm looking forward to hearing insights from today's discussion that I can use to help inform future policy development and to help ensure Australians have a safe and secure home.
That was Senator Jane Hume in a recorded address to us. Jane Hume is the first Minister for Women's Economic Security in Australia. We thank her for her contribution today and we look forward to working with her and the federal government to enact some real solutions. She says she wants to hear from us, so let's make sure she does. The issue of homelessness for older women is one that has been under the radar until pretty recently, but it is still largely a hidden problem. To help us understand these issues better, it's time to hear from Linda Hahn, a lived experienced advocate. Linda is based in Brisbane and is actively engaged in advocating for the housing needs of older women in Queensland via the Housing Older Women Movement, HOW, H-O-W. Thanks so much, Linda.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you everyone for the opportunity to tell my story of housing stress and homelessness. As you listen, please remember I am just one of over 400,000 older women in Australia who face the daily challenges and ongoing trauma that arise through not having a safe, secure, and affordable home. This forum is geared to move us from awareness to action. These women need solutions now. And that is why we formed the Housing Older Women Movement. My story. I started buying my first house at age 19 and have owned homes in the UK and Australia. So I never imagined I would experience homelessness. Only when I discovered I was not the only one that this had happened to, did I stop feeling ashamed of my situation. I've come to realize that my experience is not my fault, nor due to poor choices, but rather the inevitable result of systemic, economic and societal factors which increase women's vulnerability to homelessness. Older women are generally the invisible homeless, who quietly struggle to get through each day, not yet often visibly homeless on the streets, but only a step away from that. It could happen to any woman you know, your mother or grandmother, your sister, aunt, co-worker, your friend or neighbour. I have predominantly worked in community-based organisations where pay is lower than in other sectors. Some positions have been part-time, and I've taken career breaks to raise my family, care for my elderly relatives, and I now provide childcare for my granddaughter. Historically, society has relied predominantly on women to undertake these unpaid carer roles, which in turn impact on our capacity to build a secure economic platform for our later life. Nonetheless, I thought I was on track for a comfortable retirement until, at age 53, the persistent and unresolved stresses of my job managing a disability advocacy service stopped me in my tracks. And I was signed off work by my GP. I was literally burnt out. I had nothing left and was overwhelmed with fatigue, swiftly followed by depression, anxiety, and panic attacks. The deterioration in my mental health impacted on my relationship, and two difficult years later, I packed my car and returned to my support network in Brisbane. And that is when my homeless journey began. I survived 3 years of temporary insecure housing, making 18 moves in those 3 years. I moved between living with friends and with my son and daughter-in-law, spells of house sitting, staying in B&Bs and caravan parks, and informal rentals found on Gumtree. It felt like an unending cycle of unnerving dislocation. And it exacted an even bigger toll on my life because you never feel settled or peaceful when you've no security about where you're staying. You can't plan, you can't focus, and you can't get your life back on track. My life had literally fallen apart. I'd lost my health, my job, my marriage and my home. I recalled images of Humpty Dumpty and the nursery rhyme in pieces on the ground. That was how I felt. Shattered and in pieces, and I couldn't imagine how I was ever going to put myself back together again. Those were some of my darkest days, when I felt constantly exhausted and experienced feelings of desperation, literally not wanting to wake up in the morning. So what you see today, 11 years later, is a version of Humpty, just about together again, but there are still cracks, and it doesn't take much for them to reopen. A word about how I've managed financially. When I returned to Brisbane, I had just $30,000 in superannuation and some savings, but no income, and I was nowhere near well enough to work. 2 years later, my share of the property settlement was not enough for me to buy, so I added it to my super and set up an income stream, which has sustained me, but I'm spending it down quickly in paying private rental that's more than 30% of my income. For health reasons, I haven't been able to meet mutual obligation requirements, but I've recently been assessed to go on the disability employment scheme, so I now receive Job Seeker. Aussies have many wonderful phrases, one of which is, she'll be right. But no, she'll not be right unless things change. Awareness has to be followed by action. Addressing the housing crisis is simply the right thing to do. No older woman should face homelessness in Australia. Let's act together to ensure that older women in Australia will be right. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Linda. And just from what I was seeing in the chat, your story really resonated with so many people. And it's so important that we're hearing from Linda and others who know this issue intimately. They know it best and have the understanding to be able to inform solutions and actions. And we are realizing that some of this material might be triggering, might be distressing. We need to have the honest, frank conversation. But if this is challenging for you, please do take note of these resources. We will also put them into the chat so that you can access them if you need, but please understand that we're not trying to trigger anyone, but we do want to have a frank conversation. So, but thank you again, Linda. Next up is our political panel, and we're going to hear from some well-known women in federal politics. Joining us today are Tanya Plibersek, Shadow Minister for Women and Labor MP for the seat of Sydney, Queensland Senator Larissa Waters, who's also the co-deputy leader of the Greens and spokesperson for women for the Greens, Zali Steggall, the independent federal member for the seat of Warringah in Sydney's north, and from the ACT, lived experienced advocate Penny Leimhuis, who will talk about her life and what she wants from our leaders. Each of our speakers will have 5 minutes, and then we'll have a Q&A discussion, including questions from you, the audience, so please do send them through. So first up, Labor's Tanya Plibersek, a former Minister for Housing in the last Labor government who oversaw a program of building additional public housing. She's also held the portfolios of Health, Human Services, Status of Women and Social Inclusion. So Tanya, it's over to you. You've got 5 minutes.
Oh, well, thank you so much, Karen, for emceeing today. Thank you, Georgina, for the welcome to country. And I want to acknowledge that I'm on the land of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation and pay my respects to their elders past and present. And thank you most particularly to Linda for sharing her story. It's not an easy thing to do. And we are very grateful to you, Linda, for giving us an insight into just how easy it is for someone leading an ordinary life to become homeless. And when I was the housing minister, remember the first woman I met in the electorate of Bennelong who moved into some of the public housing that we built in the seat of Bennelong. And she told me her story. She brought in a beautiful sponge cake and told me her story. She was a woman in her early 60s whose husband had basically organised their finances all through their lives. And when he retired from his job as a banking executive, he went to live with his second family, the second family that he had had all along for years. There she was with no bank account in her own name, no checkbook, no credit card that would work, basically just the clothes that she stood up in. And she was one of the first to move into the public housing we built in Bennelong. But no, one of the things that was most interesting about that period was that instead of the residents of Bennelong welcoming the fact that she could stay in her own community amongst the people that she knew and the services that were familiar to her, instead what we saw was an astroturfed political group set up to oppose the building of public housing in a whole range of areas where we built public housing. And it just makes me so furious when people pretend that housing homeless Australians is politically controversial or something that we should be having a fight about. When we were in government, I built as housing minister 21,600 new public housing dwellings, the first 35,000 national rental affordability scheme dwellings. That was a program cut by the Liberals. We started the Housing Affordability Fund, which brought hundreds of thousands of more affordable properties onto the market. We built 80 new homelessness services coming out of the Housing White Paper. We started First Home Saver accounts, which were got rid of by the Liberals when they came in and then reinstituted with a different name. Federal governments can and should be building public housing. I still visit common ground buildings in the cities. I go to Melbourne, I see there's two beautiful common grounds we built there. There's one in Sydney in my electorate that we built. Go to Brisbane, I see the common grounds we built there in Canberra and other places. Of course, federal governments should be playing a role in housing all Australians, making affordable rental more available, making home ownership possible, and making sure that we deal with the crisis end of accommodation. And Labor has a plan to do that if we're re-elected. We've already said that we would set aside enough money to build 20,000 new social housing dwellings, including 4,000 specifically targeted for women and children escaping violence, and an extra $100 million for crisis and transitional housing options for older women, women and children fleeing violence and others. We've said we'd have another national housing and homelessness plan if we win government. And I think it's interesting that Jane Hume was prepared to say earlier that that the federal government is still, spending enough, I guess you would have to assume she's saying, on housing. In fact, when Labor left office in 2013, we were spending about $2 billion a year as a nation. The federal government was spending $2 billion a year on homelessness programs, Indigenous housing and other housing support programs. That's 2013. Take it to 2021. Look at what's happened with population and inflation. The equivalent spend should be $2.7 billion a year. In fact, we're spending $1.6 billion a year, which means that we are not just spending less than we did in 2013, we're spending dramatically less than we should be just to stay where we were in terms of level of effort in 2013. We've got so much more that we should be.
Oh, we seem to have lost Tanya. We'll see if she comes back on, but her time was close to up anyway. But definitely thank you very much, Tanya. It was good to hear what has been happening and the to-ing and fro-ing and the chopping and changing of policies. Now we're going to hear from the Greens co-deputy leader, Larissa Waters, who speaks in the women's portfolio. She doesn't hold the housing portfolio, but can speak broadly about the Greens' pretty ambitious plan to tackle the supply of public housing as well as overhauling rental policies. So, Larissa, the floor is yours for the next 5 minutes.
Thanks so much, Karen. And I want to add my acknowledgement of the traditional owners of the land that we're all dialing in from. I'm here in Meanjin, so I acknowledge the Turrbal and Jagera people. And because sovereignty was never ceded, it is and was and will always be Aboriginal land. Thank you to Aunty Georgina for your beautiful welcome. And thanks, Karen, for emceeing, and in particular, Linda, thank you. I found your story incredibly moving, but sadly, way too common. I want to add that Senator Maureen Faruqi is our fabulous Green spokesperson on housing, but as Karen has said, I hold the women's portfolio, so I'll come at this issue from the perspective of women. And we know the statistics. We know that before COVID, it was women over 55 that were the fastest growing cohort of people facing homelessness. Since COVID, that's come down to women over 45. Which is terrifying and utterly unacceptable. We know now that there's about 400,000 women who are either homeless or on the brink of homelessness. And this is a wealthy nation like ours. It is utterly unacceptable. Homelessness and poverty, for that matter, is a choice that governments make with the policies and the budget decisions that they take every year. Now, in Queensland, we've got 47,000 people on the social housing waiting list. There's almost 9,000 of those who are children, and people are waiting an average of more than 2 years. I want to share briefly a couple of examples of women who've contacted my office in recent times. A woman in Yarrabah, one of our First Nations communities, rang my office to say that she's been on a social housing waiting list for 23 years, and she's now got 3 kids that need a roof over their heads too. I spoke with a woman on the Sunshine Coast recently who's living on the aged pension. She was facing eviction into homelessness because she couldn't afford the $80 a week increase in her private rent that her landlord was proposing, because, you know, he wanted to make more out of people coming up from the southern states. There were no other suitable, affordable homes for her on the private market. Another young woman that I spoke with was given crisis accommodation during the first COVID lockdown, but once that wasn't available anymore, she had to sleep in her car. Now, my office helped to get her some accommodation, but the local providers that we ultimately found something for her with are all overstretched and under-resourced. And every single support service that I met with in Queensland tells me the same thing. There is no crisis accommodation, there is no transitional accommodation, and there is no long-term affordable accommodation. Now, we know that many women who are facing homelessness are in that predicament because of domestic violence, and I note that there's a panel session coming up about that. Now, not only do we need vastly more funding for education and prevention programs, and we need to quadruple the amount of funding for frontline DV response services to meet existing demand, let alone future demand, but we also need to talk about housing. Sadly, all of those DV plans and programs that we have that are underfunded often don't address the desperate need for housing. And I want to just flag that I know it's even harder for First Nations women, for women with a disability, or for women who are coming from cold backgrounds. So how do we fix it? Well, there's numerous things that should be being done. The Greens think we need a massive social housing build. We welcome Labor's announcement of, I think Tanya said 20,000. That's a good start. The Greens think we actually need 1 million social homes built, funded by the federal government via a housing trust that states and territories and community housing providers could apply to for funds. They would, they would provide affordable housing and rentals based on household income, secure long-term leases, and make sure that, of course, that there was mobility, environmental and accessibility design features factored in. We know it's been done successfully in other countries, Denmark, Sweden, the Netherlands, and it can be done here. Now, we would pay for that by winding back the obscene tax incentives of capital gains, discounts, and negative gearing. Now, those tax settings have actually made the private market worse as well. They are the reason why we're in a housing bubble and why there's no affordable homes for anyone wanting to enter the market, and why private rentals are becoming unaffordable as well. So not only would changing those tax settings help fund a massive social housing build, it would also then fix the problems in the private market. So we want to wind back that capital gains tax discount over 5 years, and we want to stop any new negative gearing and then wind back existing negative gearing to no more than one house. because in our view, housing shouldn't be a commodity. Housing is a human right, and everybody deserves a home. And it's a bit like cake. Until everybody's had a slice, you shouldn't go back for seconds. I know that's a bit of a base analogy, but in a wealthy nation like ours, there should be no one without a home.
Now, we've seen Larissa, your time's pretty much up. So I know, but we've got time for questions, but I want to make sure we've got time for good questions.
I'll talk about the other factors influencing women's economic security then. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Larissa. Next, we're going to go to crossbench and independent MP Zali Steggall, who's the member for Warringah in Sydney's North Shore. It's not the usual place you would think typically about homelessness, but as we're discovering, we really need to cast aside the stereotypes and what we think homelessness is in order to tackle the issue. So, Zali Steggall, your 5 minutes starts now.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Karen, for emceeing. Thank you, Georgina, for the welcome to country, and may also pay my respects. And thank you to Linda for sharing a very important story. Unfortunately, one that in my previous life as a family law barrister, we came across all too often, that difficulty upon separation and change of circumstances. This is such an important forum and topic. So I thank the Housing for the Aged Action Group, as well as the University of Melbourne for hosting an event like today to put a spotlight on the issues that we don't give enough attention to. Homelessness, as many people are saying today, is a growing problem in Australia, and it doesn't affect everyone equally. Certain parts of society are more likely to face homelessness in their lifetimes than others, and older women are one of those groups, and I recognise our Indigenous women also are very much at a higher risk as well. In 2016, the census data showed that we had about 116,000 homeless, and unfortunately that's gone up. In New South Wales, that number was 37,700, and in my electorate of Warringah, which, as you say, an affluent electorate, also had around 500 homeless, and there's around 1,300 in need of social housing. The number of homeless people aged 55 years and above is steadily increasing over the past 3 years, and unfortunately we're expecting it again to be quite a shocking number in 2021. We need to talk about the concept of homelessness is also one that's quite misunderstood. And it's perhaps why maybe homelessness, it's always seen as sleeping rough or in a tent somewhere. But only around 7% of homeless people are in tents or sleeping rough. Homelessness is much broader than that and includes people in temporary accommodation, homelessness, support services, boarding houses, or even severely crowded accommodation. It's also couch surfing or staying home with families and friends. And not only are older women the fastest growing cohort of people who are experiencing homelessness, older women are also some of the most likely people to be at risk of slipping into homelessness. And those statistics through COVID are alarming. And gender is a huge factor in this. And for me, it's about the inequalities that women are facing. 44% of single women over the age of 45 are on low to median incomes. So do not own their homes and they're renting. So likewise, 50% are nearing retirement age, have a super balance of $50,000 or less, whereas the same goes only about 33% of men. 1 in 5 people receiving job seeker payments are women over 50. Now that has to be the telling statistic. There's stories of homelessness in an electorate like Warringah too. One woman recently told me her story about how a history of abuse and resulting mental health issues compounded by financial insecurity pushed her repeatedly into homelessness. And it's been only through stable and affordable housing that she's been able to regain stability in her life and of her children. But like so many other older women, the history, her history of financial inequality and homelessness now leaves her, she's heading into a retirement age with meager savings, potentially facing homelessness again. And we can't allow that to happen. Financial and housing stress is disproportionately affecting older women. And so we're seeing those numbers increase. But there are ways that we can address the problem. In Warringah, a local organisation had the opportunity to establish a shelter for homeless women, for older women in unused other accommodation. The project was done in partnership with a community housing provider and had the support of local council and was incredibly well supported by the local community. Similarly, during the original COVID lockdown in March last year, I was really pleased to be able to advocate for and support that the Manly Warringah Women's Resource Centre in their efforts to set up a pop-up women's shelter here in Manly in recognition of the increased demand for such facilities. But the problem was that those initiatives, as great as they are temporary, and they rely on sporadic funding, and they need to be made permanent. An ongoing solution, which is consistent, reliable resourcing from all levels of government and the private sector. I've called on the federal government to invest in social and affordable housing to make this more of a priority. Policies such as mandatory inclusionary zoning, in where a portion of all new housing is designated as affordable housing, have been tried at a local level for years, and we know that they work, and we know that they could work at a state or a federal level too, but we actually need that political will to implement it. We need to address the economic inequities between men and women as well. When we look at our four large tax concessions, including, as Larissa mentioned, negative gearing, capital gains tax, discounts, superannuation tax concessions, and excess franking credits, that's 70% of the benefits of those programs flow to men overwhelmingly. So we've got to take into account when we examine how to make our tax system more equitable. At the moment, it is gender biased.
Yes, Zali, I am going to jump in there just because we are running behind and we will have a chance to pick up on some of this. So excuse me, but we'd want to get to our final speaker in this particular panel, which is Penny Leimhuis. Penny's a social justice activist who lives in the ACT and is one of the many older women who have found themselves homeless. She's now a passionate lived experience advocate on behalf of women. Welcome, Penny.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you to our other speakers. So for 12 years, I lived as an owl amongst you. Owls are what older women who are lost in housing are known as. Like hundreds of thousands of other women aged 45 and over who are single and do not or will not own their own home by the age of retirement, I walked amongst you. Hidden, voiceless, human collateral damage. Blatant, gender and systemic inequality drove me to the premises of homelessness. The circumstances that brought me to this position were created by a tragedy of commons, one that is impacting ours at an escalating rate. As we heard, solutions are possible, available, and sustainable. Policy reform across government, addressing women's current superannuation inequity and building an adequate supply of public and social housing are needed now, not tomorrow, now. Women in this cohort, age 45 and over, have experienced across their lifespan casual low-paid employment with little or no superannuation, gender pay disparity, under and unemployment as a result of caring responsibilities, relationship breakdown, family violence, job loss, acquisition of an illness or a disability, superannuation deficits in relation to cost of housing, home ownership and low retirement savings and minimal pension payments. Gender inequality and no policy response to the housing issue of secure, affordable, accessible housing options has led them right up the path to no home. And it will happen to the next generation. We are literally the collateral damage of systemic gender inequality and inadequate, affordable housing supply. I was one of the canteen mums of my generation, contributing to Australian society, socially, economically, and community, helping sustain it. Not paid, not recognised, not valued, still doing. I volunteered for our children's school and raised my own children as well as other people's, cared for others in the community, worked part-time in casual jobs, no super, no financial security, but a big heart. No access to superannuation. In my 30s, I was able to work full-time and able to access superannuation. Several years later, I had an accident and sustained a significant and permanent disability. Unemployable. Not disabled, a person with a disability. in 2004, a relationship breakdown and minimal financial settlement meant that I couldn't afford to purchase my own home. Rent can quickly consume my finances. Like so many ours, I found myself living in rooms, renting a house that was untenable, unsafe, unaffordable. The pension is not sufficient for basic living expenses. I didn't recognise I was in that position until I had nowhere to go. Until then, I managed myself, as we do, renting a room in a house or finding inappropriate housing. I moved 7 times in 12 years. The cost of moving is prohibitive. The mental and emotional toll is excruciating. Each time I moved, I lost the connections I'd made, my friendships, my community, my essential physical supports. Because of the lack of affordable housing, I was forced to move states twice, leaving behind my children and my grandchildren, forced from one turbulence to another. I moved to a bigger city in the hope of obtaining affordable housing. It was a fallacy. The situation was worse. Disruptive, insecure, and a constant undercurrent of fear, anxiety became my normal way of existing. I didn't have anywhere to go. I went to my GP and it was a really low point, the lowest I've ever been. And I faced some challenges in my life. This was the worst. She suggested a case manager or a psychologist. Didn't need a case manager. I don't need a psychologist. I needed a service that would link me in with an affordable, secure, accessible housing option. The majority of ours have led conventional lives, and for them, homelessness is their first time experience. Additionally, many have never dealt with a service organisation in their past until they are homeless. Many of the women I speak with are reluctant to even access a service, let alone know where one exists. I applied for public housing and was told I'd be 65 or over before I'd be offered anything. I was in my early 50s. Again, I moved 3 times in 3 years. Renting a room is not a home. There is a shame and an embarrassment experienced by ours. Many feel helpless, hopeless, and powerless. Suicide ideation is a common thread. My pride diminished to nothing. Each move, each loss of connection, every realisation of poverty eroded my sense of worth, my place in my Australian society. We will not be collateral damage. We will not be silent. We demand our right to policy reform for our generation, for our daughters, our granddaughters, the daughters and the sisters of Australia. Thank you.
Thank you, Penny Leimhuis. A really powerful, moving speech of what it's like to be in a situation where you really don't know when you might feel secure in your own home again, or if you might feel secure. Penny, I want to actually put our first question to you, if you're still around.
Yeah.
Having listened to what you've listened to so far, what's the one key practical change that would make the biggest difference to your situation and that 400 odd thousand women over 45 who might find themselves in your situation?
The one key thing at the moment would be social housing and public housing, an increase in social and public housing. That's at the top of the tree. The other things are fundamental and fall beneath that. But at the moment, given the extent of the crisis, housing is needed now.
And I'm going to say, Larissa Waters, there was quite a lot in the chat about that 1 million homes that you've talked about, a lot of support for that for sure. That is a very, very ambitious program. Mm-hmm. You've also touted some, you know, changes to rental rules, changes to tax and other incentives. But how does a small party with a big agenda like that actually get it up? In reality, how do you get 1 million homes built?
Well, we're hoping that when the election rolls around, we see the back of the current government. And I try not to be too political, but women have gone backwards in the last 8 years. We are less safe, we are less financially secure, and we are less heard than we've ever been before. So speaking personally for myself, I can't wait to see the back of the current government. And I'm hopeful, and it looks likely, that the next election may well give us another hung parliament. And with the Greens in the balance of power working with a different government, we're very hopeful that we could see some serious action on housing and on climate change and gender equality for that matter. But it's looking positive. Obviously, that's up to the voters. No one can control that but the folk of Australia. But that is our goal. But I might just add that it's a powerful thing to advocate for bold policies. It helps change the Overton window, what's seen as politically possible. And I might also add, this is what the services are telling us is what's needed. This isn't some pie in the sky that the Greens think would be a nice idea. We've had it costed. It could be delivered. We need a government that is serious about actually fixing problems rather than papering over them and just mudslinging the other parties. Homelessness is a choice by our government, and it's one that no government should be making. So not only could we fix it if there was a role for the Greens in that balance of power situation, but I think if any government listened to what the experts and the service providers are saying, change those policy settings, we could actually fix this problem. These problems are not intractable. They are choices being made by government.
I want to talk about the market distortion that so many government policies, yes, social housing is really important, but affordability across the board is really problematic, particularly for older women. When you look at the policies of negative gearing, capital gains tax, there's been reference to all of these. Firstly, I want to come to you, Tanya Plibersek. Labor has said it will stand with the current policies. Why does it seem to be in the too hard basket to have shift to housing to be a basic right rather than what seems to be the Australian way of an investment opportunity?
Well, I think we do have to conceptualise housing as a basic right, and that doesn't mean if you're a family that owns your own home and you want to sell it for more money than you bought it for, that's great. Good luck to you. But there's a bunch of people who don't fit into that, group, who for whom we need to make sure there is social housing, as Penny said, community housing. We need to look at more innovative options like shared equity. Big housing providers, community housing could be working with people. One of the biggest groups of people who risk homelessness in that cohort of older women are women post-divorce. We know what happens. You get a divorce, you divide your assets. In lots of circumstances, the bloke's hidden half of his assets. You've got a small amount of money, not enough for a deposit for a home, not enough to buy your own home. But if you look at cooperative models, shared equity models, there's a bunch of innovative ownership models that we could be using in Australia that we don't use. So social housing, community housing, shared equity, cooperative housing, all of these things should be on the agenda. And that's the reason that we want to have a national housing and homelessness plan in Labor that looks at all of these issues. The background material... One thing. The background material has a quote from the Department of Social Security, the federal government, saying that housing is predominantly a state and territory responsibility. It's just not true. Housing is the responsibility of every level of government. You need local government doing its share on zoning and the other stuff it needs to do. You need state and territory governments that predominantly run social housing, public housing. But you also need a federal government that gets the settings right so that it contributes actual dollars into new build for public housing, and it gets the other settings right. The RBA pointed out
I do want to, sorry, Tanya, I just want to keep this moving. We're just wanting to talk about two, and Zali Steggall, I know, has got some views on this in terms of these kinds of policies that happen. And we have a really skewed housing. It's great. Those policies you've talked about, Tanya, are really, really interesting and really important. But we do have this idea. And, I think somebody might have been Larissa telling me yesterday, the beneficiaries of capital gains tax exceptions, negative gearing, are primarily men, and we've got this women's housing problem. So how do you juggle? How do we shift the debate and have Australians understand that we've got this skewed housing market? Zali.
Yeah, thank you, Karen. And look, I'd actually, I think that there is that aspect that 70% of much of our tax system, the major benefits are incredibly gender skewed. So we have to address that problem. And I think it fits into the broader problem of women are retiring with not enough superannuation. But I have to probably take issue with something Tanya said. In family law, in breakups, it's not just a question that, you know, the allegation that blokes are hiding the assets. The problem is couples are breaking up with insufficient assets. And if financially they were doing it tough, which has maybe caused the breakdown of a relationship, they then find themselves where having these assets that are insufficient have to provide for two households. Their two homes need to be set up. And there's simply not enough assets. And more often than not, the male has been a breadwinner and can continue on to an earning capacity. And the women do not have that earning capacity. So they do not have the ability to set up. We need to be looking at things like carers' allowances. We need to ensure that our policies from the beginning, from paid parental leave, from, you know, pay equities all the way through, is ensuring that women have the same opportunity to retire with superannuation. I mean, all the policy triggers, you know, when you talk about negative gearing, the difficulty is housing has been seen as an investment stream, rightly or wrongly, for 30 to 40 years. And that is not something you can just wind back quickly. But you have to acknowledge the consequences of that policy. And then you have to make sure we're putting in place the adequate additional policies to ensure we're dealing with the problem. So mandatory housing zones, allocation percentages. I mean, we are a nation that just develop, you know, housing development is occurring at max rate. A major policy of the government in recovering from COVID was home builder. There was nothing there, though, that was linked towards actually requiring addressing homelessness or housing security for women and for older Australians. So I think it's just that we always need to have, across every policy sector, we need to understand better and acknowledge the consequences. When legislation comes up in Parliament, I do reach out regularly to ACOS, to a number of bodies, to understand from their perspective what are the impacts. I've met with Senator Hume to discuss. She hasn't taken on board all the things that I've asked her to consider, but we need to be really practical in how we shift the dial.
There was a report this week that during this latest lockdown in Sydney, while women made up 80% of the decline in employment in July, they only received 40% of the disaster payments. This is after Enough is Enough. This is after the Women's Safety Summit. This is, you know, we know all of this. Why are women so reluctant to either take them up or, you know, what's the issue here? Penny, you have real thoughts about the stigmatising of Australia, particularly older women. Tell me, how do we change the narrative and get political leaders to understand that they actually need to, you know, maybe you just need to pay women 20%, 15%. What's the pay gap? Maybe you just need to pay women. What are your thoughts, Penny, on how this can be rectified?
I think there's a number of factors that play into that. And I think there's a complete lack of recognition by the current government that women are just not, they're able to get a job, then they can go off and access in an emergency job seeker or any other form of whatever benefit might be available at that time. I think when you're talking about the stigma, a lot of that has to do with our sense of pride. And as women, we are so socialised to be polite, to be nice, to ask for things rather than accept that that's our basic right and our due as part of society. And I think in terms of addressing the pay gap, the women are most likely to be the ones taking on the caring roles. We hear now all the women who are coming out saying that during lockdown in particular, they're doing homeschooling, they're trying to juggle work as well. So that already they're at a disadvantage. Those factors all need to be considered and taken into account.
Thank you. Larissa, we know ageism is alive and well. Just ask any 50-plus woman who's applying for a job or even applying to rent a house. How do you address the challenges of both ageism and homelessness amongst older women when clearly we've got a whole lot of blokes in our federal parliament who don't want to listen?
Well, we need to start having a few less old white guys running the show in parliament.
and having a lot more women in Parliament, a lot more people that genuinely represent our community. So diversity across all of the different measures. We might get some more lived experience then that could actually deliver policies that address the real situation so many women and Australians are living in. So yeah, first things first, let's fix the representation in our Parliament. But Penny spoke really powerfully, and I agree with everything she said about the fact that women's economic security is what is underlying, or lack of, is what is underlying the homelessness predicament that so many of us are facing. We need to close that gender pay gap. We need to make sure that a lifetime of care doesn't result in retirement in poverty like it does at the moment. That's our reward for caring for firstly our kids and then often our elderly parents, is we retire into poverty. And if you don't already own your home, by the time you get to the aged pension, there are more than half of people on the pension that don't own their home who are technically in poverty. So we need to lift job seeker. It is below the poverty rate. It is not helping people to find work. It is punishing them. We need to lift the minimum wage, and we could legislate to do that. Sadly, that would disproportionately affect women. I know that's normally independently managed, but I think there's a role for the Parliament to step in and fix that, because at the moment, the poverty crisis is getting worse. COVID has made it worse. And as you've identified, it's gotten worse for women because we've naturally been the ones that are expected to pick up the burden of the extra domestic care, look after the kids when schools have been closed, somehow juggle work at the same time. I'm sure many of us have had to face that, some with more support than others. So there are these policy settings that can fix all of this. And if we fix women's economic security, then we can start to address what's driving that push towards homelessness.
Tanya, I know you wanted to have something to say, but I'm also wondering whether you can weigh in a little on, you know, what's needed for income support for women. Why can't we just pay women the gender gap? Why don't we just do that?
Yeah, well, we can. We can reduce the gender pay gap by changing our industrial relations system. We've seen wages flatlining for the last 8 years because collective bargaining has, you know, lost its place and in our industrial relations system. So we need to change IR. We need to have more transparency. We need to address the gender pay gap. We've got policies to do that. We need to address the super pay gap. We've got policies to do that. But I just want to take it back a level. One of the reasons that we're talking about these unequal taxation benefits and so on is because Australia is no longer a country that does proper gender analysis in its budget papers. We used to lead the world in looking at how tax measures impact women and men differently, how social security measures impact men and women differently, how IR measures impact men and women differently. This government doesn't do that anymore. And so they've got, like, I don't know, four different ministers that have got women in their title. Because they had this kind of political problem a while ago, you know, women didn't like them very much. But what you need is a whole system that with every decision that goes to the cabinet, the question is asked, what is the gender impact of this decision? How does it affect men and women differently? And then you ask yourself, okay, if there is a differential impact, are we still going to do it this way? So one example is tax cuts at the top end versus a low income taxation offset that is targeting people on the lowest incomes. Well, we know that the second thing has a much better impact on women, or for women, than tax cuts at the top end. That's why you would choose, you're going to spend $1 billion on tax cuts, you choose to do it this way, not that way. It's not complex. It's actually about will.
Great, thank you. Zali, the pandemic has made it pretty clear that there's votes in supporting tradies and big business. How can older women make their vote count? Do they have to go marginal like Warringah or do a really aggressive campaign on the ground? How do you make your vote count as an older woman?
You have to make your vote count. I mean, everyone's vote needs to count on a lot of issues. And ironically, you know, my pet one of climate change is ironically a massive one that will impact women around the world, especially in developing nations. Absolutely. And I think you have to be smart about looking at policies and how they're going to be impacted. But look, it's not, obviously your vote counts. We need more women in Parliament because I think if you're not at the table, you're not going to be discussing it. And I think there's nothing like I think too many, when they're structuring programs, it's just not front of mind. Two really real examples we have at the moment was JobKeeper in lockdown was really not well adjusted for casual workforces, and that impacted mostly women. So women, especially households, for example, where second income earner might have been the woman on a casual employment, because maybe earning caps and things like that, was not able to access JobKeeper. So it was like a message that your second income of that, your family, is not the important income here, or you don't need to support that. The closed border policy, that immediate family, for example, parents for when women are having childbirth. So women are needing to take time out of their careers to have children, need the support of family. Now, I don't think the blokes have appreciated the importance of that, because they're not physically having to do it somehow around cabinet. And as a result, again, it's women in those situations that are taking a hit, because they're having to choose between their health, their personal health, their career prospects, and their caring responsibilities. So there's many times where these issues come around and you just need more women around the table. So you do have to vote women into parliament. And it's why I'm here. I was frustrated.
I think we're all in furious agreement about that. There's been in the chat some discussion about people wanting to see politicians work together. And it's great. You know, I think there's a lot of furious agreement amongst the three politicians we've got here. Tanya, I want to put to you, if there is a change of government, if Labor is elected, what will you do to connect across parties, cross benches, to ensure that there is multi-partisan support, and that there is sort of layers, that you're not having the layers of, oh, well, this isn't my responsibility, yours. What will you do?
Well, I think I work pretty well with both Larissa and Zali, and with a lot of the crossbench. I can't pretend that I can convince the Liberals to invest in housing at a federal level, though, because my experience of being the housing minister is when we wanted to spend billions of dollars building public housing in Liberal electorates, they set up community groups to oppose the building of public housing in those electorates. And I mean, to be really honest with you, Larissa, the million house thing is a fantastic idea. I love it. But there were green groups. There was one I ran into in Kiama that vociferously opposed the public housing being built in Kiama. So you can't pretend there's always going to be agreement about this stuff. All I can say is, judge us on our record. We did it when we were in government. We've already got money on the table to do it again. I love working with independents and the crossbench if we possibly can. I hope the Liberals will come on board this time. That'd make a nice change.
I'm going to go to Penny again. Penny, again, you've been listening, paying attention. Got some thoughts? Do you have any questions you want to quickly put to our panellists here? I'm putting you all on the spot. But
okay, so I put out the plea, and it wasn't an ask. It's a demand. Work together. I know there'll be intricacies. And I think we need to address some of the issues around stigmatisation, stereotyping. Really, it's not that hard. I think all those points that have been made about women need to be more in politics. Yes, I do. Well, if they're not actually there, invite us to the table. There's lots of advocates out there.
I want to do a quick whip around. Thank you so much, Penny. Your contribution today has been absolutely fabulous, as was Linda's earlier. I think I do want a quick whip around to our political guests here. Very quick answers if you can, because we've only got a couple of minutes. One of our asks today of our audience is to contact their MPs, to try and put some political pressure on. What works? What's going to make you stand up and take? I'm going to go with you, Zali, because you're the top of my screen. Very quick, please.
Look, I get a lot. If I could give you about 23% of the cases that have come through my office have been older women needing assistance around Centrelink and things. So we are actively trying to help. A high proportion of my staff are older women. So we are absolutely focused on the issue. A huge amount of actually my team is. So absolutely write to me. We do need the lived experience. We need the feedback to know, how to advocate. I'm an independent. I'm not a party. So I am absolutely here to represent my community. So I need my community to really put forward the solutions. But also there is a lot of proactive people in my community that are looking at the issues and looking for solutions. So I do believe we need to take the politics out of it and make it more community-based.
Larissa Waters, quickly, what influences you and your office?
Well, we don't need much convincing, I'm afraid, because we're already signed up to equality and providing homes for everyone that needs it. But my tips for how to convince others to be stronger on these issues would be tell them that you will change your vote if they don't change their policy to address the issue that you're facing, and share your story. We heard from Linda and we've heard from Penny. It can't not get you in the heart to listen to these women who could be any of us and through no fault of their own are now facing homelessness. So that's powerful. Share your story and let the person you're writing to know that this matters so much to you that you won't vote for anyone that isn't going to address this issue meaningfully.
Tanya Plibersek, quickly.
Yeah, email, write, phone, visit, go to street stalls, come to the events, tell your story, talk to members of parliament, and actually be prepared to vote on it, because I've got to say, I think this is one of the most critical issues facing Australia today. For older homeless women we're talking about today, the next generation of young Australians, God knows whether any of them will ever be able to afford a home of their own unless we get this right.
Look, thank you so much. I would like, there's been a whole lot of stuff in the chat that I haven't really been able to share with the three of you in particular, but I'm hoping that we might be able to send some of that on to you, the comments, the et cetera, because I think it's really important that you see it. Some of it was very specific for your parties, and I didn't want to get bogged down in particular policies. But I thank you all, the three politicians and our fabulous Penny Leimhuis, for a really great discussion there. And yes, let's work together because it's such a big, important problem. So, we are now, we're going to take note of what you've all said too. We're going to hold you to account. We're going to, I know there's lots of people who've been taking notes to make sure that that we don't just talk about it, that we actually do it. And we want you to ensure that you're following the progress of others as well, and working all together to ensure we're holding all of our leaders to account. So we are just about at the time we're going to take a 10-minute break, after which we'll have three breakout sessions. One looking at older women, housing and family and domestic violence, local scale solutions and influencing for change. You will have an opportunity to pick one of these breakout boxes to go to. And if you've got any technical problems, we can help you. But we'll give us some quick instructions after the break to ensure that you're able to do that. But a clap for our political panelists, for all our speakers in this first session. It's been really, I think, inspiring. We've had a lot of really good discussions, a lot of heartfelt discussions. So please go grab yourselves a cup of tea or coffee or whatever is your poison at this time of morning, and we're going to come back at 12 o'clock sharp. So thank you so much, and a big hand to all of our speakers this morning.